Latest front in the GOP war on women is happening in the grocery aisle. The
Republicans in Wisconsin are ramping up the war on women. The war on women alive and well. How do you read it?
Do you think that there is something of a war on women among Republicans?
I think we have to fix that.
Republicans are being accused of waging a war on women for something they're doing that is very different than what the Democrats are doing.
Republicans swear there's no such thing as a war on women.
All out war that your party is waging on women.
It's a war on your parts is what it is. Well, we're not doing a show investigating the typical sex inequalities. We're going to be a little more contrarian today and throw a few grenades. Is there a war on men? Let's ask our dapper party panel. It's lawyer and feminist writer Jill Filipovic and Gavin McInnes, contributor at tackymag.com. All right, so Gavin, you've written a lot about this controversial and
yes.
unpopular topic, so I'm going to start with you.
Okay.
Are men being discriminated against?
Yes, clearly. I mean, the data shows it, from danger in the workplace to alimony payments to all these perpetual myths that, like, women make less money than men. And we accept it because we can take it on the chin. We're very nice guys. But I'm getting sick of it. I'm getting sick of the way we're portrayed in sitcoms. I'm getting sick of the way fatherhood is trivialized and single motherhood is put on a pedestal, because it's bad for America. And I used to think women were too stupid to understand this, but let's treat them like grown-ups and say sexism in 2014 is a myth, and we're going to have to get back to what matters, and what matters is fatherhood.
Okay, so you're saying that alimony is totally skewed because men end up paying more of it, although women earn a lot more money now than when the laws and the rules were kind of set in place.
40% of women are breadwinners in America, in American households. 90% of the alimony payments are by men to women. Yep. The numbers don't add up, and women should be able to do the same math that men can do. No?
Jill?
I think your math is bad. Women are 40% of breadwinners in American households because of so many single mothers. You have a lot of women that were never married in the first place when they have children. So they
yeah, and they choose
anyone.
That lifestyle, and that's child abuse.
Well, they don't have anyone to pay those alimony payments to.
What?
Alimony payments are gender neutral. There are plenty of women pay alimony payments to husbands.
No.
And same with child support payments.
No.
Madonna
plenty
lost $76 million on her failed marriage
yeah.
to Guy Ritchie.
She's not your typical broad. Look, the alimony concept was invented when it was the Nona cooking a spaghetti the whole life, and then she gets a band, she goes, I made spaghetti for you guys my whole life, and now I don't know how the skills. But now that women are working in the real world.
I didn't realize that's what it was. I'm so glad
yes.
you
I didn't realize alimony was invented
down.
In Italy.
Yeah.
It was invented for
It was
immigrants.
Called alimony.
It was invented for old-fashioned moms. We got new moms. You want equality? You don't get alimony. Sorry.
I think it's important to distinguish between facial, the kind of equality that you're talking about, which is you're basically saying that women shouldn't have, you know, money to provide for their children. Men shouldn't have to pay money to provide for their children. When men actually petition for child, or I'm sorry, for custody of their children, they're very likely to get it.
What?
That's actually not true.
That actually is.
That is total bull.
When men actually request custody of their children, they almost always get at least joint custody.
Men always lose custody battles.
There's a huge difference between they almost always get joint custody. I mean, there's a very big difference.
There's a massive bias against men on custody battles.
It's rare in contentious divorce proceedings where both parties are advocating for sole custody of the children. Most people that get divorced do actually come up with child support settlements and child care agreements that both parties can agree on.
Do you agree with Gavin
really
about fatherhood? That fatherhood is the missing link in society, and if there were more dads, I don't know, kids would be better off?
Yeah, I think fatherhood is a missing link. Yes, I do actually agree that we do need to talk about things like workplace injuries and deaths among men, that we do need to talk about the fact that men are much more likely to commit suicide and succeed than women, that we have a mental health care crisis among men, that men in America and around the world do suffer. But I think a lot of that suffering comes out of traditional gender roles and these expectations that men act tough, that they don't display emotion, and that they don't seek help. And I think that's also why we have a fatherhood crisis. I think all of these issues matter.
I think those are two different things.
I actually think feminists who are coming up with
solutions. To your first point, we're actually coming out of that, and we've rounded the bend on things like mental health.
Feminists see single motherhood and they go, sisters are doing it for themselves. And sisters are abusing their children. If you have children knowingly as a single mom, you're starting a child out with a disadvantage.
Did your parents stay married?
Yes. They
okay,
did.
Well, sometimes marriage doesn't work out, Gavin.
Sometimes marriage doesn't work out.
It doesn't make you a child abuser.
It does. If you choose to be a single mom, which is the majority of single moms.
Gavin, I think that's a weird claim. Sometimes marriage doesn't work out, and sometimes dad is a jerk. He's just an awful person.
Let's talk numbers.
And you actually don't want him in the household.
But let's
get back to some of these outcome disparities that the conversation seems to revolve around. Because I think it's wrong for us, and I've done this before with race stuff, I think it's wrong for us to focus on the disparity and not focus on exactly what the phenomenon is and just accept the fact that sometimes there are outcomes and the outcomes happen to be disparate among men and women and there isn't some sort of conspiracy being perpetrated against anyone. You said that sexism is dead. I would agree. It's probably dead. And perhaps there are some social values that are producing some not intentional or deliberate consequences, but are perhaps producing some things that we don't necessarily intend.
It may well be intentional. There's evidence that the CIA funded
Ms. Magazine. And there's nothing you can do about it from a policy standpoint at all.
That's actually true.
Okay, that's
sure.
It sounds really funny coming from
Gavin. We reward single moms with welfare payments.
Okay, but
we reward destroyed families.
Hold on just a second.
I would love to see you survive off of welfare payments. It's not like women are living high on the hog with their, $300 a month to care for their children.
It's not $300 a month. Welfare with food stamps and more than three kids is more like $1,200 a month.
Okay, so Jill, let me ask you this. Is sexism dead?
No, sexism is not dead. Sexism is alive and well. If you look at the statistics, even among American women, which I know one of Gavin's talking points is that, if you want to find sexism, you have to go abroad, and American women are just fine. American women do make less money. Yes, the gender gap has been pretty much, not entirely erased, but it's been very much condensed among young single women without children. But as soon as
make more money, young single women without children, that's make more money than men.
That's what she's saying.
No, that's not what I'm saying. I'm not saying
that's
they make more
saying.
Money.
How do you argue with someone who just keeps making up figures?
I'm not making up figures. Where
single
are you
women without kids
so, Jill,
make
what are,
more money
what are
than
the
men.
Figures? Like, which figure do we trust? Because the president has been talking about 77 cents, that women make 77 cents on the dollar for every man. What are the figures?
And
what
is debunked a lot
and
of
what
that.
Can
and
we actually
it's
accept?
Not just maternity. It's also men are more willing to do things like ask for a raise. And men are more willing to work in more difficult jobs that pay them a greater salary. It's not as cut and dried as, and by the way, Gavin brought up a really good point. If employers thought they could get away with paying people 77 cents on the dollar, all major companies would only hire women.
They do it with illegal aliens already.
I wish that was true.
All
I
right,
mean, there's
another
a,
show, Gavin.
There was a really interesting study that was done, I think, 2 or 3 years ago, where they had we were looking at resumes of people applying for jobs as lab assistants, and these resumes were identical in terms of work experience and education, and all they did was change the name on the resumes from male to female. And what they found is that the male-named resumes were accepted and offered higher salaries overwhelmingly versus the female-named resumes. And the only difference here is the name. So I do think that there are some deep-seated sexist ideas within American society. Nobody's going out and saying, I don't want to hire a woman.
Yeah.
What they're doing is they're reading a male name and they're inferring into that a level of competence.
It's called post-judice. They've seen these males stay up all night. It's the definition of post-judice. They've noticed a pattern and they said, gee, my male employees tend to stay here all night, whereas my female employees tend to prefer to go to their daughter's ballet recital. I think I'm going to err on the side of my experience, which tends to be I'm more profitable when I hire men.
Okay, so Jill, if sexism alive, is there sexism against men?
I do think that there is. I don't want to compare the discrimination that men face and the challenges that men face to the longstanding institutionalized oppression that women have faced for centuries.
Okay.
I think those are two different things. That doesn't mean, though, that men don't face very serious challenges, many of which I do think stem from these traditional ideas about gender and who should be doing what. I think sexism hurts men and women alike.
All right, well, Jill and Gavin, we're going to have you guys back to talk about something really uplifting and fun. They're going to be talking about divorce a little later in the show, and that's going to be great. It's going to be so calm and wonderful. All right, thank you both. We're going to see them in just a few minutes. From men to boys, if you have a son, you might agree with our next guest, the war on pint-sized men. Is it on? Stay with us. It's The Independent. It continues in moments.
How's about fucking Scotland?
Run and you will live. But what would you give to come back to this day and fight against the fucking English? Am I right? See, my parents, they're fairly garbles and bollock shaws. And the thing about Scotland as a wee man is that I notice people like a bit of patter. They like joking around. I remember I was running with my gran for the bus, and she finally caught the bus, and she says that the bus driver opens the door, and he goes, "Just you keep running, hen, you're going to get down to him before I do." Scotland is about making jokes, being offensive, being crude, and being rude. So, in about 1974, my parents moved to England when I was born. I was born in Itchen, not far up the road. And I know it's the same sort of deal, right? Mucking about. Geezers mucking about. And I thought, everything I liked about Scotland, when I visit my gran, is eminently true here. We go to the pub as a baby, they'd bring me to the pub, they'd banter on about, they'd have a fag, not a homosexual, it's a cigarette. They'd probably have a fag too, I don't know what they got up to. And we would come to Speaker's Corner when I was a wee lad. And I remember being a faint memories as a toddler going to Speaker's Corner. I didn't know what anyone was on about, but I knew they were mucking about, and I knew they were on about something. And I just knew I liked it, right? So then, we moved to like Canada in about 1975 or so. So I go down there and I just go, "Hello, everyone, I'm perfectly chuffed to be here. I want to get a Parker and I'm very excited about Canada." And they just went, pounded the accent right out of me. And then I was a Canadian. So I stay down there, right? And I'm like, this fucking rocks. And we're joking around. We came with a lot of Indians in the early 70s, right? And a lot of, you know, you'd get beat up for an accent back then. And it was our way of sort of making everyone Canadian. And within a week, you know, you're smoking a dirt and you're fucking fighting during hockey and all that. And fucking going to the fucking DOA concert and fucking slamming and shit. You got a 2-4 under your arm. And then I moved to America in the 90s. Yeah, boo. Boo it up. Oh, Uhuru, that's different. That is the Zimbabwean word for freedom, I believe. So then we're in America. And I've had a pretty good run here in the Western world, in Scotland and England and Canada and America. And I look back now and I think, what's happened to my culture? What happened to the West? We got a guy up here from Scotland who is arrested for teaching a pug to Sieg Heil. That's a fucking joke. And he likes to talk about how it's about context and everything.